Hello and welcome to a new episode of Secure Synopsis Discussion and Analysis. Today we will be discussing about the Secure Synopsis of 29th of April 2021, starting off with General Studies 1. The first topic is on social empowerment. Though women in India have made some progress recently, India's performance in Global Gender Gap Index released by the World Economic Forum proves the progress is insufficient due to the prevalence of gender-based discrimination, and we need to elucidate this question. So we all know that women are still facing discrimination in the country. There are jobs, but women are not in those kind of jobs. In the higher management, mostly men are occupied. And the first time if the company wants to shed their work, their employees, it's the first thing that they do is they take the women out of the companies. So women have faced, discrimination, and that is the reason why there is still a gender gap and lack of participation of women in the main sectors. Now let's have a look at the answer to this question. India has slid 28 spots to rank at 140 among 156 countries on the World Economic Forum's Global Gender Gap Index. This pandemic, causing a disproportionate impact on women, jeopardizes rolling back the little progress made in the last two decades, forcing some women to drop off the workforce and leaving them vulnerable to domestic violence, right? So during the pandemic, most of the women have quit their jobs so that they can take care of their families, and they're staying back at home. It might be their own choice, or it might be the company's choice of relieving them off. Now let's have a look at the body of this answer. India's performance in gender gap and inequality. India scores quite low when it comes to the gender inequality. According to latest UNDP Human Development Report, India is ranked 125 of 159 countries in the Gender Inequality Index. Labor participation. In terms of labor participation, only 23% of women, wherein 79% women above 15 years are part of India's labor force. So, and there is a huge amount of wage gap too. Research from India's leading diversity and inclusion consulting firm Avatar Group shows that women are paid 34% less than men for performing the same job with same qualifications. There is lack of economic empowerment. Women are underrepresented in senior managerial positions and overrepresented in low-paying jobs. Oxford survey shows that globally 19% firms have a female senior manager. Access to productive capital. It is harder for women to access funds and capital for farming, starting a business, or for other development works. Secondary education for women is lower than men in majority of countries, while this stands at less than 80% in India. Social norms and stereotypes. Classifying men as breadwinners and women pursuing jobs as career women was reported by Oxford University survey. It also highlighted that most of the unpaid work is seen as a woman's job, right? Now let's have a look at the suggestions in this answer and need of the hour. There should be a behavioral nudge. For instance, by using taxes to incentivize fairly sharing childcare responsibility, or by encouraging women and girls to enter traditionally male-dominated sectors such as armed forces and information technology. Example, Supreme Court in India declared that women could now hold commanding positions in army. They should also be given paternity leaves for men to share the responsibility of child rearing, incentivizing companies to employ women and reach 50% target. Gender justice at work should be the main phenomenon, agenda. Bridging the wage gap for equal work, making workplaces safer through strong laws. India has enacted Sexual Harassment at Workplace Act. Promote diversity and anti-bias courses for all employees. Comprehensive leadership training for women to excel in their fields. Gender sensitization, breaking the social barriers by gender sensitization and education of families, schools and workplaces. Example, in the NCERT books, gender roles, bias and prejudice inducing writings were removed. Social security and financial literacy, formalization of jobs should be pushed to avail benefits to many women. Until then, social security benefits should be provided to women in unorganized sector. Example, self-help group, bank linkage program in India. Embedded financial literacy programs where women have significant representation could be a good starting point. Strong laws and policies with respect to equal pay for equal work, maternity benefits are needed to promote women's representation in economy. Political representation also. India has provided 33% reservation for women in the panchayats and local bodies. Capacity building and training can increase their capabilities further. Now, what's the way forward? Learning from the Nordic region, noteworthy participation of women in politics, institutions and public life is the catalyst for transformational change. Women need to be equal participants in the labor force to pioneer the societal changes the world needs in this integral period of transition. Every effort must be directed towards achieving gender parallelism by facilitating women in leadership and decision-making positions. Social protection programs should be gender responsive and account for the differential needs of women and girls. Research and scientific literature also provides unequivocal evidence that countries led by women are dealing with the pandemic more effectively than many others. Right, so gender equality is a human right which entitles all persons, irrespective of their gender, to live with dignity and with freedom. Gender equality is also a precondition for development and reducing of poverty. Gender shouldn't be an unreasonable determining factor curbing the potential of women. Let's move on to the next topic, that is of under the General Studies 2. And here the topic is issues relating to development and management of social sector services relating to health, education, human resources. Do you think exam-centric education system that only creates hyper-competitiveness and perpetuates inequalities needs to be dismantled? Now, this is with reference to the article that appeared in Indian Express. And let's have a look at the answer to this question. Because during the pandemic, we saw many students could not write exams and many people could not write exams of the competitive exams. And we see that if exams are really required to assess a child's or a student's capability of learning, or there should be another way. Let's have a look at the answer to this question. With the aggressive return of COVID-19, we are experiencing heightened anxiety. And amid this turmoil, we are also witnessing the breakdown of normalcy in our education system. As board exams get cancelled, there was time when board exams were considered to be one of the most important part of the education system. And these are again being postponed also in some states. Students, parents and teachers are at a loss. Now let's have a look at the body of this question and answer. Expectations from a good education system. Schooling does not always lead to learning. Worldwide, there are more non-learners in school than out of school. Quality learning requires a safe, friendly environment, qualified and motivated teachers, and instruction in languages students can understand. It also requires that learning outcomes be monitored and feedback into instruction. Accessibility, affordability, and quality are the three ingredients needed. Such an education system must increase the curiosity of young minds and give them freedom to explore their interests. Thus, an education system must sensitize children and make them humble wanderers. It must activate their patience and endurance, cultivate the ethics of care, prepare them to pass through existence with songs of collective redemption, right? So problems with the exam-centric education system is, to begin with, let it be stated clearly that these standardized tests or exams are by no means neutral. With a huge difference in their access to social, cultural, economic capital, the performances of children from various social backgrounds are bound to differ. Moreover, the absurdity of these neutral exams becomes clear as we look at the digital divide in the country and accept that much hyped online teaching learning is a myth and has done injustice to those who cannot afford it. It is important to deconstruct our schooled mind and realize that kind of exams we are familiar with this by no means the substance of meaningful education. Instead, the ritualization and tyranny of exams cause immense psychic anxiety, generate widespread fear, and above all, deprive the entire experience of learning, unlearning, exploring of a sense of joy, wonder, and self-discovery. Instead, they transform one into a clever strategist. One is trained by coaching centers as well as school teachers obsessed with the exam performance of their students to master the technique of giving the right answer. Hence, every subject is reduced to a set of exam riddles. Third, this exam-centric education breeds fear, envy, and superiority-inferiority complex. In a way, it legitimizes hyper-competitiveness as a way of life. It is inherently against the spirit of reciprocity, symmetry, and cooperation. Let's go on to the conclusion of this answer. The art of relatedness, humility, the ethos of sharing and trust in the innate possibility and uniqueness of every human soul. We do not allow our children to develop these qualities. Instead, schools orient them to be warriors. It would not be entirely wrong to say that the sort of exams we have taken for granted is the worst form of violence we inflict on the consciousness of young children. Very good sentence. Here it says that the sort of exams we have taken for granted is the worst form of violence we inflict upon the consciousness of young children. Discuss the need for India and Pakistan to evolve a policy to ensure and guarantee prisoners their rights and early repatriation. India and its neighborhood relations. Answer to this question, fishermen. This is mostly related to the fishermen who venture out of the Gujarat coast and they enter into the Pakistani waters, or the Tamil Nadu fishermen who enter into Sri Lankan waters and they get caught. They are jailed over there in those jails, in those countries' jails, and are never left out. right? And the same holds true with the Pakistani fishermen in India and Sri Lankan fishermen in India. Fishermen from India, especially the Saurashtra region of Gujarat, often get arrested when they unintentionally cross over to the Pakistani waters. They suffer, and so do their families, who are now even more worried because of the COVID-19 pandemic. Despite an agreement being in place, these are not implemented, thereby violating basic human rights of people. India-Pakistan agreement on prisoners on consular access. India and Pakistan signed the agreement on consular access in 2008. Though the deal has a few lacuna, it was significant. Section 4 of the agreement said each government shall provide consular access within 3 months to nationals of one country under arrest, detention or imprisonment in the other country. So three months is the minimum time. Further, Section 5 of the agreement stated both governments agree to release and repatriate persons within 1 month of confirmation of their national status and completion of sentences. More than 300 Indian fishermen remain in Pakistan's custody in Malir jail. Consular access is an exception. Without it, the nationality of the person is not confirmed and the repatriation process cannot begin at all. Though the agreement does not state a time limit, there are numerous instances in which both countries have not confirmed nationality for as long as 18 months. Imagine, almost 1.5 years, during which the arrested men languish in jails, wasting their crucial time of life. Now, there is a need for a better policy. Ideally, prisoners should be released and repatriated the day they complete their prison sentence. But this has happened in just one case with Hamid Ansari, the only person who was released and repatriated on the day of completion of their sentence. In 2007, India and Pakistan set up a joint judicial committee on prisoners comprising 4 retired judges from each side. The committee used to convene twice a year to meet prisoners. It made unanimous recommendations, including on the release and repatriation of fishermen and women prisoners. Its last meeting was held in 2013, after which it was discontinued. In 2018, efforts were made to revive it, but Pakistan has yet to nominate judges or call for a meeting. It is in the interest of both nations that the committee be revived and most expeditiously look into repatriating those who have completed the prison term. Another way of dealing this can be to return those prisoners who inadvertently cross borders of fishermen who are caught unaware. Both India and Pakistan have a seat on the UNHRC, and it is despicable that they are not addressing the violation of human rights in their own backyard. Despite the hostilities, it is time that the two nations work out a solution for the cases of fishermen languishing in jails and help them get back to their lives. It can be a start to the diplomatic lull between the two nations. Let's move on to the next topic, and this topic is under science and technology, developments and their applications and effects in everyday life. Achievements of Indians in science and technology, indigenization of technology and developing new technology. Growing importance of semiconductors or chips, integrated circuits, and China's experience with the manufacturing and design of some same provides a strong case for focusing on chip designs in India. Now, this is mostly related to semiconductor industry, because semiconductors are used in manufacturing of cars, and if these IC chips or the in limited quantity, the cars cannot be rolled out, because even if a single part is missing from a car, the customer would not be ready to buy, and the car manufacturer will not be able to sell the car at all. So because of this, there is delay in car manufacturing, there is delay in car delivery. And let's have a look at this topic, and this is in reference to Business Standard newspaper. So semiconductor shortage is turning into an acute issue. Due to it, the growth prospects of auto industry are once again in jeopardy. This issue also offers immense opportunity for India to foray into integrated circuits and chip design. Now, let's have a look at the body. Background to semiconductor and chip shortage. The global $450 billion semiconductors industry got blindsided due to the global pandemic after a massive demand for semiconductors. Semiconductors are typically silicon chips that perform control and memory functions in products ranging from computers and cell phones to vehicles and microwave ovens. The world saw an unprecedented demand for servers, internet connectivity, and cloud usage as online collaboration grew massively during work from home and during the pandemic. And according to the EY report, the semiconductor industry was already facing a demand-supply crisis, and the delay in imports from China after the Indo-China clash at the Galvan Valley added fuel to the fire. The OEMs, that is equipment manufacturers, faced massive supply chain issues after the government implemented curbs on imports from China. The crunch led to supply chain issues as the industry relied on a few giant players. Ford, Nissan, Volkswagen, Fiat Chrysler, and Toyota are some of the top automakers that curtailed production amid a global semiconductor shortage. Operations of mobile manufacturers Lava and Micromax were almost stuttered to a halt after its chipset supplier MediaTek ran out of stock. Why India must focus on chip design? The semiconductors form the DNA of a wide variety of new-age gadgets like smartphones, computers, industrial equipment and cars. They are also sought for emerging markets of AI, computing and advanced wireless networks. The semiconductor industry carries huge potential. It is a highly demanded commodity. There is a huge scope not just in the domestic market but also to emerge as a global supplier. However, the industry requires heavy capital expansion. Before manufacturing semiconductor chips, India will need to be self-sufficient in manufacturing printed circuit board assembly. It is the board on which the various electronic components are mounted. As per the Indian Cellular and Electronics Association, the current market size for PCBAs in India is about $16 billion. It is expected to grow to $87 billion by 25 to 26. ICEA says that the government support 99% of the PCBAs can be assembled in India. Hence, there is a huge incremental opportunity. Also, it will reduce the imports drastically, making Indian manufacturers more competitive. Challenges in this regard: the scarcity of semiconductors in the past few months brutally exposed India's original equipment manufacturers' soft underbelly, their heavy reliance on imported components. The government has also introduced an ambitious production-linked incentive schemes to encourage in-house production. The most important here is semiconductor or chips that form the central government of items from auto to laptops and mobile phones, as the current disruptions show. It is an area where we can ill afford to depend on others. India currently has a limited number of fabulous startups and companies with state-of-the-art R&D centers focusing on chip design. The business also requires hefty running costs, and technology needs to be upgraded typically every 3 to 4 years. Conclusion: as a global shortage of semiconductor looms, it would make sense for India to focus on chip design rather than manufacturing. Make in India and assemble in India can work seamlessly if India's capabilities in this regard is amplified. Then let's move on to the next topic, and this topic is under General Studies 3. The topic over here is issues relating to intellectual property rights. We're going to read something about the IPR and how the pharmaceutical sector is dealing with this IPR regime. Critically analyze the global patent regime with a focus on the pharmaceutical sector. Even an unprecedented pandemic can do little, it appears, to upset the existing global regime governing monopoly rights over the production and distribution of life-saving drugs. If anything, since the onset of COVID-19, we have only seen reaffirmation of intellectual property rules that have served as the lethal barrier to the right to access healthcare over the last few decades. Now, what is a patent? Let's have a look at some of the information about a patent. A patent is a conferral by the state of an exclusive right to make, use and sell an inventive product or process. Patent laws are usually justified on three distinct grounds: on the idea that people have something of a natural and moral right to claim and control over their inventions; on the utilitarian premise that exclusive licenses promote invention and therefore benefit society as a whole; on the belief that individuals must be allowed to benefit from the fruits of their labor and merit. When a person toils to produce an object, the toil and the object become inseparable. Global patent regime: even when the world is grappling with the pandemic and vaccine inequality, the small set of countries such as the US, UK and EU to continue to block the move to remove strict patent clauses. On October 2nd last year, India and South Africa submitted a joint petition to the World Trade Organization requesting a temporary suspension of rules under the 1995 agreement on trade-related aspects of intellectual property rights. A waiver was sought to the extent that the protections offered by TRIPS impinged on the containment and treatment of the COVID-19. As we now know, quick and efficient vaccination is the surest route to achieving global herd immunity against the virus. Should the appeal for waiver be allowed, countries will be in a position, among other things, to facilitate a free exchange of know-how and technology surrounding the production of vaccines. The follies in this new world order became quickly apparent when drugs that reduced AIDS deaths in developed nations were placed out of reach for the rest of the world. It was only when Indian companies began to manufacture generic versions of these medicines, which was made possible because obligations under TRIPS hadn't yet kicked in against India, then the prices came down. But lessons from the debacle remain unlearned. India's patent laws, the colonial era laws that the country inherited, expressly allowed for pharmaceutical patents. But in 1959, a committee chaired by Justice N. Rajagopal Iyengar objected to this on ethical grounds. It noted that access to drugs at affordable prices suffered severely on account of the existing regime. The committee found that foreign corporations used patents and injunctions secured from courts to suppress competition from Indian entities, and thus medicines were priced at exorbitant rates. To counter this trend, the committee suggested and Parliament put this into law through the Patents Act 1970 that monopolies over pharmaceutical drugs be altogether removed, with protections offered only over claims to processes. This change in rule allowed generic manufacturers in India to grow. As a result, life-saving drugs were made available to people at more affordable prices. Now let's go on to the conclusion. We cannot overlook the need for global collective action. The pandemic has demonstrated to us just how iniquitous the existing world order is. We cannot continue to persist with rules granting monopolies which place the right to access basic healthcare in a position of constant peril. In its present form, the TRIPS regime, to borrow the law professor Catherine Pister's words, represents nothing but a new form of feudal calculus. Let's go on to the next topic. GS2, issues relating to development and management of social sector services relating to health, education, human resources, achievements of Indians in science and technology, indigenization of technology and developing new technology. Explain why antimicrobial resistance is a silent threat of the coming future. Examine the causes for growing AMR across the world. So antimicrobial resistance is the ability of an organism or microorganism to stop an antimicrobial means such as antibiotics, antivirals and antimalarials from working against it. As a result, standard treatments become ineffective, infections persist and may spread to others. Antimicrobial resistance is a silent threat of future. Before that, let's have a look at this. Causes of antibiotic resistance. Antibiotic resistance happens when bacteria change and become resistant to the antibiotics used to treat the infections they cause. Overprescribing of antibiotics can lead to antibiotic resistance. Patients not finishing their treatment can also lead to this. Overuse of antibiotics in livestock and fish farming. Lack of new antibiotics being developed. Lack of hygiene and poor sanitation. Poor infection control in hospitals and clinics. Let's have a look at antimicrobial resistance is a silent threat for future. Antibiotics have saved millions of lives till date. Unfortunately, they are now becoming ineffective as many infectious diseases have ceased to respond to antibiotics. Antibiotic resistance occurs when bacteria develop the ability to defeat drugs which have been specifically designed to kill them. Infections caused by such resistance germs are very difficult and often impossible to treat, and it can affect humans at all stages of life. AMR is occurring across the globe and is severely affecting the treatment of infectious diseases. Even though antimicrobial resistance is a natural process, the misuse of antibiotics in humans and animals is accelerating the process. A large number of infections such as tuberculosis, pneumonia, gonorrhea are becoming very difficult to treat since the antibiotics used for the treatment are becoming less effective. Globally, use of antibiotics in animals is expected to increase by 67% by 2030 from 2010 levels. The resistance to antibiotics in germs is a man-made disaster. Irresponsible use of antibiotics is rampant in human health, animal health, fisheries and agriculture. Complex surgeries such as organ transplantation and cardiac bypass might become difficult to undertake because of untreatable infectious complications that may result post-surgery. Reasons for growing AMR across the world. Antibiotic resistance occurs naturally, but misuse of antibiotics in humans and animals is accelerating the process. Poor infection and prevention and control further accelerated. While in humans, antibiotics are primarily used for treating patients, they are used as growth promoters in animals, often because they offer economic shortcuts that can replace hygienic practices. In their quest for survival and propagation, common bugs develop a variety of mechanisms to develop antimicrobial resistance. The indiscriminate use of antibiotics is the greatest driver in selection and propagation of resistance bugs. It has the potential to make fatal even minor infections. Wrong diagnosis. Doctors sometimes prescribe antimicrobials just in case, or they prescribe broad spectrum antimicrobials when a specific drug would be more suitable. Using these medications in this way increases the risk of AMR. Inappropriate use. If a person does not complete a course of antimicrobial drugs, some microbes may survive and develop resistance to the drug. Also, antibiotics recommended by quacks or a pharmacist contribute to magnify the issue. Measures being taken. The World Health Organization is also coordinating a global campaign handled with care to raise awareness and encourage best practices for antibiotic use. In India, the government has launched a national plan on antimicrobial resistance as well. India's NAP, National Action Plan to Combat Antimicrobial Resistance, goes hand in hand with the World Health Organization's Global Action Plan for AMR. A UN Health Ministry His antimicrobial resistance awareness campaign urges people not to use medicines marked with a red vertical line, including antibiotics, without a doctor's prescription. In 2012, India's medical societies adopted the Chennai Declaration, a set of national recommendations to promote antibiotic stewardship. The government has also capped the maximum levels of drugs that can be used for promotion, growth promotion in meat and meat products. On July 19, 2019, the central government banned the manufacture, sale and distribution of colistin and its formulations for food-producing animals, poultry, aqua farming and animal feed supplements with an immediate effect to prevent AMR. Antimicrobial resistance is a global crisis that threatens a century of progress in health and achievement of the Sustainable Development Goals. Unless the world acts urgently, antimicrobial resistance will have disastrous impact within a generation. Achievements of Indians in science and technology, indigenization of technology and developing new technology, awareness in the fields of IT, space, computers, robotics, nanotechnology, biotechnology and issues relating to intellectual property rights. What do you understand by quasar? What do quasars have to do with black holes? Explain. Now let's have a look at the answer to this question. An international team of astronomers have discovered the most distant radio cloud, quasar, with the help of European Southern Observatory's very large telescope. It took 13 billion years for the quasar's light to reach Earth, according to a paper published in the Astrophysical Journal. Quasar is a short for quasi-stellar radio source, which is how these objects were discovered. About 60 years ago, astronomers saw strange star-like objects in visible light and radio service. Today, we know that not only are these objects quite distant, they are also powered by accretion into a supermassive black hole. Concept of quasars. Quasars are very luminous objects in a faraway galaxies that emit jets and radio frequencies. They are only found in galaxies that have supermassive black holes, which power these bright disks. However, 90% of them do not emit strong radio waves, making this newly discovered one special. Most active galaxies have a supermassive black hole at the center, which sucks in surrounding objects. Quasars are formed by the energy emitted by material spiraling around a black hole right from being sucked into it. Quasars and black holes. There is a black hole being behind every quasar, but not every black hole is a quasar. To become a quasar, a black hole must meet a few criteria. It must be supermassive, millions or billions of times the mass of our sun. Such black holes are found in the center of most large galaxies, but even then, not even galaxy hosts a quasar. Specifically, a quasar is a supermassive black hole that is actively feeding on material. The falling matter has swirled into a disk that has heated up, and it shines so brightly that its light drowns out the rest of the galaxy around the black hole. There are supermassive black holes that are unfeeding so voraciously. These are not quasars. Some are relatively dormant, like our own Milky Way's central black hole. Others are active, but not active enough to outshine their host galaxies. Astronomers call them active galactic nuclei, and often and they come in a variety of flavors. Quasars simply top the list for the brightest active galactic nuclei. A quasar seems to be a relatively short-lived phase of a black hole's life. So a black hole that is quiet today may have once been a quasar, and the quasars, if we see in the distant past, will eventually turn off after they have consumed everything around them. Thank you so much for being part of this video. I hope you had a fantastic time learning and listening to this video. Please press the like button and also subscribe to my channel for more such videos. Thank you so much, and have a good day.